China, the outlawed, people going to church, but because of outlawing it, Christianity grew. Are you aware of the statistics? That before Mao Zedong took over China and banned Christianity, there were about 5 million Christians in China. When he banned it and it went underground, when in 1988 China was opened for visitors, a research was done and showed there was 50 million born again believers in China. Currently it's estimated 110 million Christians in China. So that Christianity seems to thrive better when you close it down. Okay, my message? That there isn't anything you can do. People have tried all they can. Nero in the first century tried. But we are here to show Christianity never died. And you need to understand currently the attack on Christianity is subtle, is totally different. Just this week, Obama announced officially that America must accept homosexuality as normal. That it must not be seen as abnormal. It doesn't matter what the Bible says. For them, what the Bible calls abnormal. You know, Romans uses very strong words on homosexuality. Look at Romans talking about people who are homosexuals. And the description is God has given them up. But Obama says it's normal. He's going to campaign on the basis that Christians are wrong. It's okay to be homosexual. You see, what will happen with that is that if you want to be a politician and you want to be in Obama's party, it will be very difficult for you. Do you get the message? So it will mean that a lot of Christians will have to find a way of justifying that fact. That is not an attack of taking you into prison. But to be politically correct, you end up compromising Christianity. And that's another way of making sure that you can't be a Christian. But I want to tell you, for those of us who trust the law, even when you require political correctness, and even if you may not get a job because of making a stand, you know we will get deeper in the Lord. In fact, Christianity does not seem to know how to thrive where there is no attack. I can give you a bit of facts. In 1948, when there were about 5 million Christians in China, in Britain, which is a Christian country that used to send missionaries, about 20-something% were attending church. Then the years that followed the Second World War, Britain ended up having growth in industry and income. Their per capita just grew. There were wonderful years of Britain. When they did the research towards the end of the 80s, about 40 years later, only 6% of Britain was attending church. So you can see clearly, having an easier time, democracy, that communism and giving and giving. Okay, the point? So that you need to understand that when you come as a Christian and you are comfortable, chances are your Christianity will be harder to live than when you discover that wherever you go to work, for years I just about graduated, and you go to a staff room and you say you are saved, and they just burst into laughter. They wonder, surely, are you mad? Now, how can you be here? How can you be a Christian? I want to tell you, your Christianity is likely to last better than another staff room. When you say you are Christian, this is wonderful. We like people like you. Then they take you to a bar. Now, you need to understand, that the devil knows the best way to get you is to make you comfortable. Are you with me? Our topic is not that today. Our topic is how to be a witness of the Lord Jesus Christ, one-on-one. In other words, we are not talking about crusades, we are talking about every Christian becoming a witness, one-on-one. But I want to start, the reason I'm starting at this level of being sure about your Christianity, even in my attack, is that you'll never be able to do one-on-one if you are not sure about your own Christianity. Because you got to approach somebody who is a non-Christian and you laugh, they make you look like a fool. Will you approach them again? Not possible. But if you are absolutely sure about what you have, being better than what they have, because he who is in us is greater than he who is in the world. Have you read that? So that means the first point to evangelism is that assurance that neither death nor life, like Romans 8 tells us, can move us from the love of Christ. If you don't have that as a basis, my subject today is irrelevant. You must begin at the point where you believe in Christ and you count it a privilege and you find it very useful. I was sharing this just yesterday on this, that I will never forget an experience I had at Kenyatta University. Then it was a university college, 1978. I was a young graduate, I had left and I was now invited to be an assistant. During their university mission, I was invited as one of the assistant missioners. And the way it was done those days, there used to be, you went to the main speaker would speak in the main hall. Then we assistant missioners would go to the halls of residence. And then there will be groups. So each assistant missioner led mission work in each hall. So the hall I was given, as we arrived in the place, non-Christians were very keen to come because the CEO was offering nyam nyams and some drinks, and everybody came. Even the ones who had not gone to the main meeting, now from the halls they came for the interviews. Now the good thing with the students is that they are very proud. As we are preparing and arranging the place, the Christians are arranging the room. The one of the non-Christians say, "Hey, you know Christians don't believe in hell." I can tell you, my friends, the Christian students, feel that attack. This is what you mean. Now, he was almost being eaten alive. I told the Christian boys, "Why don't you arrange first? Then we discuss normally." After the place was arranged, we are given our drinks, we are now settled. I say, "Now, can you repeat what you say?" And the young man said, "Yes, I meant it. Christians don't believe in hell at all." And I told the Christian to wait. So explain yourself. He said, "For sure, I don't believe Christians believe there is hell. My mother is born again. I've just come from recess. And I was with her. One thing I can tell you about my mother is that she loves me. She's proud about me. But for the 3 weeks I stayed there, she never told me to get it. I can tell you, if you believe I'll go to hell, I know that lady loves me. There's no way she would not have told me about me." You know, that kind of silence thing, the Christian, nobody was anymore putting up their hand. He went on to say, "My roommate is KU." Although then it was KUC, it was still a college in 1978, it was not yet a university. My roommate is a born again believer. And I can tell you, as soon as we are given the room to share, we hate all together. We like each other. We enjoy each other's company. But I can tell you, for the last semester, he never told me about getting saved. But one thing I'm sure about him is that the guy has, we are good friends. Do you think if he knew I was going to hell, for all semester, you're not going to be going to hell? There's no way.
they are friends. But that time I now look for any Christian wanting to talk. Nobody was willing to talk. I was now left alone to have to reply to this young man. That was 1978. That how many years ago? That was 5 years ago, isn't it? That I have never forgotten that experience. Because I can tell you, the reason why you don't witness are twofold. Number one, you yourself are not proud of your Christianity. You are not sure that there is something you have the other person needs to have. Number two, you don't believe that the other person is in a bad place. You don't believe he's going to hell. Those are the two circumstances. I can tell you, for example, you go to your family meeting in December. Around a lot of families have their family meetings in December when the cousins come together. Am I right? Am I right? Do you have family meetings where your uncles and cousins come together? Now, at that point, you are the only person who is born again. All your uncles, all your cousins are people who don't care for the word of God. And you stand there, we wonder. We are going to be a whole day together. Do I tell them about the Lord? But remember, you are not sure about yourself. You dare not. Because first of all, you know you are a cousin. Car is their leader. They came driving. You came on the 11th, too late. Now you need to understand, as you think about the thing, and you feel like, I cannot be of my cousin about the Lord. Because after all, you better than I am. Send me. Are you getting the message? That there is no way you will do any witness until you are so sure you have the done now. That it's just every time you see them as people in serious need. And when you see them like that, during the family meeting, even your dear uncle, the famous one, where you're very proud that you know my name, his name is the newspaper, you look at your uncle, you laugh at him. And you think that you're going to pray and say, God, don't allow my uncle to go to hell. During the family meeting, you confront him. Am I right? There's no way. Let me ask you. If you laugh at your brother, my friend, thank you, you don't know my name, he goes in a convoy. You just have passed, you've just gone past a bridge, and the bridge bearer is so. Then you see the presentation motorway coming from the other side, ending at the same river, and you realize they all died. What are you going to do? You pack your car to the side, come to the road, and know they can shoot you in there. You stand at the road and start coming like a madman, throwing your hands up until, and of course, you know they don't stop until they're standing on the way. They normally go throwing people with the outriders. You know the outriders. But for you, since you love your president, you don't want him to die. You make a fool of yourself. You don't have to stop him going to the river. Am I right? Because you love him and you know he's going to die, you're not allowing him. I can tell you. On the second point, the first one I told you is first of all be sure that what you have is better than what other people want. The second one, if you truly believe that unchristians are going to hell, there's no way you don't have to believe that someone about preaching, about evangelism. No. Something you cannot allow you to allow them to go to hell when you love them. Am I right? So the reason why the average Christian does not witness is because of those two things. Number one, they are not sure that their Christianity is any useful. After all, I am a Christian, but I don't seem to understand calculus. Every time they are doing it, I have to ask my non-Christian friend to show me. So if I cannot even understand calculus, are there people doing mathematics here? If I cannot understand calculus, why should I be interested in him? I'll get to the point, you are not sure about yourself. So you dare not. God tells you something you are not sure about. And anyway, I'm not better than them. So what is there for me to tell them? You know, one of the things I will pray in this meeting to establish is that becoming a Christian, the Bible says, is such a major revolutionary step. It causes like moving from death to life. Have you read that in the Bible? That's how serious it is. That between assuming this, what should I call a non-Christian? No, call this one a Christian. I think if he's a non-Christian and he's a Christian, the two of them are totally different. It's like, what this one is a dead alive, and this alive alive. Okay, see the difference? But although he looks alive, is that correct?
Yeah.
That's what the Bible is telling us. We are totally different. And I can tell you, the life of a senior Christian and the life of a senior non-Christian,
oh yeah, in my terminology,
it's a totally different thing. You wake up as a Christian, and the first thing you want to do is to be grateful to God. Because you see life as a gift. A non-Christian wakes up and he realizes what a clever guy he is. If it were not for his wonderful brain, would they have picked him a Kenya Science number? He just gives a proud man about how clever he is. The two of them are in the same company, but they are totally different. Because this one believes, if it were not for the grace of God, you don't need this company. The other one believes.
It's good, he is clever.
Can you see the difference right in the morning? So when he told him to pray, he asked him to pray about what?
This head of mine brought me here.
My father's good money paid the campus. Where does God come? In. Are you getting my point? That's the beginning of the point. You find an un-Christian. And a Christian is very busy looking, planning about his life. That's why every time he sees a girl, he finds a way of hunting her down. And he wears it. Who is figure 8 and who is figure 7? And he avoids figure 7 in order to speak figure 8. Now, basically, that's what an un-Christian does. And when he sees camp, that's what they are. A Christian is different. A Christian sits there, aware that one day they need to be married, but aware that God will appoint that girl. Have you seen the difference? People know that you are serious Christian and an un-Christian. Because there are many people in this place who claim to be Christians, but they are also hunting for cows and serving like non-Christians. In fact, they are involved here and wondering, how can I be without a cow? So currently, they are very desperate. And you know, because you can look in and say, can you agree? Even for the service is very great. By that time, they are promised to appear. And you, now, if you have a child, that's a pretender. I'm not completely pretending. When you become a Christian, you are like a father in God's hands. You will be married. And he doesn't have to show you a cow here, because you're more interested in marrying next year. Are we together? Now, so, you are not a cow. Remember, Christians do not have governments. They only get wives. Just take the question from the for your father. Yeah. The one on earth can become a common ground. Let me thinking as a man, but he's refusing with him.
But he could not be moneyless.
But the one in heaven, he owns the cattle on 1,000 years. All the whole days, is.
So, and all they're asking is this come at least.
Still, you can go to in heaven. So, you know very well. If the Lord wants you to be his campus, you will produce the knife. You don't know how, but you know he will. Am I coming again? So, you sit there, not having money. Both of them, these are not money, these are not money. This one, every time he reads a book, he can't even understand anything. Why? He sees himself living, even before he lives. This one also has no money, but he sees a father who can provide. And that's the father. You see her happy, and you wonder, did you pay the school fees? Oh, no, nothing. I've done nothing. So why are you feeling so happy? Because her father is heaven. Are you getting the difference? The two of them are totally different. They are the same per capita. Remember this situation I'm showing you? They are similar. Facing the same thing, but they are facing just different. You know, just now to give you an example of what I age. I want the non-Christians. I worked for Chef for 30 years. I'm now retired. I run a consultancy firm. But when I was, before I retired, I still remember a non-Christian coming to me, another manager like me. He said, Mr. Man, are you not happy? Said, why? You will not just enter your car and drive home. I never knew that there is anything big about driving home. He said, it's not as long as you are thinking. I drive home. As soon as I reach home, my sofa set is like it has nails. I just discovered myself standing up, back to the car, and got from my door. Ever heard of that from my door? And he says, I come back, have you entered my family? Tomorrow I say I'm not going. Again, I drive home. But I cannot take an hour to my house. I just feel wanted. I must go. But for you, you just drive. And I think, you know, the issue, I have never thought that leaving one, driving to the pressure, my wife, was in the big. I never even that God for this. Because I thought it's too obvious. From then on, was I realized the non-Christian had given me a secret I never understood. That to have a family which we enjoy to go to is a miracle itself. For a non-Christian, that is not the obvious. Because the wife tolerates him. He knows there may be another girlfriend, because even though the man is here fine, it's only because of the winner. Now you need to understand. You need to understand that she sits there, not sure about it. So on a call they are engaging, there is a problem there. Am I coming again?
Yes.
So you believe in that point. So he says, you know, just gotta go home. Me and God is what I do. Until during 1982, as I told you, I started working in the 70s. 1982, there was a coup attempt in Kenya. And during the coup attempt, the follow-up was a curfew. We were put on curfew bomb. It happened on the 1st of August. So the whole of, in August, we actually were supposed to be home by 4 o'clock. See, because by 6, you had, if you are caught anywhere outside your house at 6, you are arrested. Then, after the first 1 month, they moved it to 9 o'clock. So we had camped for about 4 months. Now, I remember being in a lift with some women, or the only man. They were speaking Kikuyu, but they did not think I was a Kikuyu. And they were saying, have you ever heard that? When will this come you ever end? So I just stood there pretending not to be at the time, they are talking to themselves. They say, the one man is saying, it must end. I can't stomach my husband. He can go so angry. I have been now. Some people who currently are working. I met a lot of young people. Even me, because I'm young people. Now that you can see, I work over 35 years. More than 5 years. Someone who left 20 years ago is your father. But I'll call him young. You can forgive me, isn't it? Now, so when I hear me talk about mentally young people, they may not be your age. They may be your father. Now, I want to tell you, I was talking to some young people, and they told me about a problem they're having at work, and I was supposed to be helping them. And they said about this person has not been pulling his weight. He's not performing. So the Christian supervisor decided to straighten. The man said he is going to Kakamega. Normally they say they want to get to it. But this one said he's going to Kakamega. And when he got to Kakamega, all those people who were disorganizing him had better watch out. Chochote, Teresa would okay. Now, because he said openly, the minute, remember, these are many of them pretend to be Christian. But now they started saying, hey, what are we going to do? By the time he comes back, we may not be alive. Now, you know, a lot of young people of your age pretend they don't believe in Christian. Until somebody tells you clearly, he wants to go to you, I'm not going to do it. And they actually start saying, well, yeah, what can you do? When you're a Christian, you know very well. Your line is in God's hands. When you become a Christian, you are in God's hand. What does that mean? If you put a glass, a water in a glass, and then you put the glass in water, you getting the difference? Yeah, you put water in a glass. Then you put the glass inside a bigger container having water. Now, do you know to get that glass out, you must start the water itself. So the Christian is in Jesus, and Jesus is in the Christian. It means that to reach the Christian, you must come to Jesus first. Okay, my word?
Yes.
There is no way the witch doctor will reach me without calling Jesus. Because Jesus, I am in Jesus. So you can't reach me unless you reach Jesus. And if you're a witch doctor, has the capacity to handle my Jesus. Amen? I may not have, by the way, this trap is real. It's not something, there are something the devil gives. And it's real. So you on your own, if you are here and you are not born again, I am not advising you to grow in riches. They can destroy you that life. So, unless you get this, but I want to tell you the difference. When you are non-Christian, you have never put the wrong of your Bible Savior. You are just over to witch doctors. They can do anything. But if you are Christian, they try. You have testimonies upon testimonies. They try anything they can. It can never, ever tackle the one that is the So when they tell you they are going to lose the witch, it doesn't bother you. You run your life normally. But for this one, they as soon as they say they are going to go there, he cannot sleep again. He may have to go to a bigger power, you know, somebody stronger with the same witchcraft. Are you getting the difference? When you start understanding the difference, then every time you see an Christian, you see somebody who suddenly needs the Lord. And worst of them, as I said, the Bible says that before we were Christians, we lived under the fear of death. Death is not a problem. The fear of death is the issue. And all the Christians don't have the fear of death. Why? When you kill me, you send me home. Surely. Who would not get to go to their home? Are you getting my question? And to kill me, you send me home. I still remember I was in charge of logistics for sure. When I was dealing with transporters, some of them, Asian, Somali, all kinds of people. One, I was canceling somebody's contract because they were not performing. And he said, do you know who I am? Came to my office. He don't know who I am. And he told me, you cut my contract, understand, your children are not in, but mine are not in. So I understand. You are capable. I'm driving a small Toyota. And you are grown up a junior campus. All you need is to switch on the side and you're not mine dead. So I do not doubt your ability to carry out your threat. However, where you come from? Have you ever heard of people who are saved? If you have. Have you ever heard them say that they are looking forward to going to heaven? And they are here? So that they are living in the dead. I think it's a point. greater than you dead doesn't do it.
Because nobody born again fears death. You can fear pain, but not fear death. In fact, if you fear death, that's the way to go, you are not saved. If you fear really want to know what you are saved, check whether you fear death. Because the Bible says that before we are Christians, we live under the fear of
death.
So as a Christian, we no longer fear, live under the fear of
death.
Can you see then that you cannot be a Christian and fear death? You can fear pain, because you are given pain to send us to a doctor. So pain is not something covered. But death itself is an open. In fact, the songwriter says, death is a door into heaven, isn't it? Because most of us, except the ones who are going to be alive when the trumpet sounds, the rest of us must die. So death is bad and good. Death is bad because it will take you away from your ministry. Death is good because it's a graduation ceremony. And now you ask me the question, when they come, when our supporters are born and they invite us to a graduation ceremony, are you going to go there crying, oh, we are graduating now? Sure, it will be a very serious. So when you attend, the funeral of a minister, you don't go crying. We go rejoicing. He has made it to heaven. Because death is the only way you can go to heaven, isn't it? So it's not something. Now, are you, remember, I am taking my time to tell you the basis of one-on-one evangelism. It is seeing the difference between you and the world. And seeing what comfortable life you live compared to the world. And because the Bible says, for God so loved the world, and you have become a Christian, so God uses you. You now love the world. So you don't want them to live the way they are living. Am I clear? So that when you don't witness, I repeat myself, there are only two possibilities. That you yourself are not living the life I'm talking about. That you don't have the joy of walking with the Lord. You don't have the joy of being assured that your future is totally taken care of. You can't sit there wondering, who will I marry? Who will I not marry? You don't even, whether you marry or don't marry, one thing you are sure, the Lord will be with you. Because it says, "Lo, I'm with you always to the close of this ages." And you're not going to die yet. So you are sure of being present. Now, if you are not there, my topic about one-on-one evangelism is just a joke. You need to come to where you are sure about your own salvation. That you yourself are enjoying the open road. I've been a Christian for more than 40 years. And every time telling the devil wants to tell you and tell you, it's no more. You are until I meet a non-Christian. And he tells me he's right. You know, right now I left the alliance suddenly around 40 years ago. And we meet somebody who are with me. Now they are there. Sometimes you have to look again to remember whether it's the same one who was with you in high school. And then he tells you this story. He says, I married the first wife, then the second one. Now I'm not remembering what wife. And I now have some children, he's at another school. And I say, what happened? You see, we don't believe in polygamy. But men and Christians have become polygamy and Syrian. Are you seeing the difference? Where they are all wives alike, but they don't really live in one. You know, traditionally, polygamy men, you live with five wives. Now, the new polygamy is when you take one and drop it, take another one and drop it, take another one and drop it. You now have four, but you only live with it. I call it Syrian polygamy. Now, it's important to when you look at this and say, how can that happen? I don't understand. It just happens. Everyone I meet, they are there. He can't stand them. And by the way, he's not very happy to be going to another school, to be taking a job to another school in his age, around 60, plus or minus. And he's taking a job to another school. He's not happy with it. But he says he's confident. There's nothing he can do. Now, I want to tell you, when you become a Christian, you may even have a difficult wife. But something more certain, it is that you dead to us, but us. And the minute you realize is that you dead to us, but you work on it. Even if your wife is a baroness, you work on shaping the lion. It's very important to understand, since you're going to be the lion, you tame the lion. If your husband is a lion, you tame the lion. and you finally leave at peace with your life. And you go, hey, you leave with that man, he's not your life.
No, you're not there.
You need to understand that when the Lord gives you the capability, remember, that's what Adam was told, he was given dominion over the earth, isn't it? So if you have become the man you have managed as a life, remember you are given dominion, isn't it? And you are able to make the teeth harmless. Now, it's important to understand that's how we are able, a Christian is able to enjoy even a difficult spouse. Because they are able to deal with them. Are we together? So, but when you're a non-Christian, please understand, the average non-Christian, the average non-Christian, does not enjoy marriage, they endure marriage. But the intention of God is not to endure marriage. The intention of God is to enjoy marriage. Now, all that I'm spending time to establish to you, that you choose the way of the Lord, your way will be totally different from non-Christian way. Now, once you understand that, should you then enjoy this way without the others? Not worried about the other people? You are going to heaven and you are going to go to heaven alone? I'll say that I want to repeat. If you are going to go to heaven alone, chances are you are not going to Christ heaven. One of the ways of knowing you are going to Christ heaven is that he will never allow you not to be interested in other people's salvation. Because for him, he's a missionary God. He sent his son. He came to us. Well, it's not human being who went to him. He went to them. Are we together? The Great Commission does not say go in, come in. It says go in. So that we are not to expect non-Christians to come to us. It is that to go to non-Christians. Are we together? Because you have a love, a desire for it. And by the way, please understand. The non-Christian does not know he needs you. He does not even admire your Christianity. He is not even interested. It is you to go to him and explain the life you live. And what are the joys in it. It's only then you can say the guy has rejected Christianity. Now there are many people in Kenya Science whom you are saying have rejected Christianity. But the Christianity have rejected, the Christ they have rejected is not our Christ. Because they grew up in a family where the mother was wearing a long dress. So in their own mind, a Christian is a person wearing a long dress. So they are taking the price of a long dress. But you look from the scriptures, the size, the length of the dress is not Christianity. Are we together? So you need to tell them about the real Christ. Don't assume that they have rejected our Christ. Have they ever heard of it? You will be surprised when you talk to non-Christians when they tell you what they think about Christianity. They have been in Christian schools, they have been in churches, but the idea of Christianity is totally different. So, the idea of one-on-one, number one, is that you should not expect people to come to you. It's you to go to them. Because of two reasons. Number one, they don't know what they are missing. So they have no idea. So how do they come to you? Number two, the Lord himself constrains you to love the world the way you love it, isn't it? So it's you who needs to go to them. So I hope with that introduction that you are going to take seriously, asking yourself, how come? Let's look at 2 Corinthians chapter 5, I'm beginning at verse 18. 2 Corinthians chapter 5, I'm beginning at verse 18. You can take it, check it in your script, in your Bible. All this is from God, who reconciled to himself through Christ and gave us the ministry of reconciliation. That God was reconciling the world to himself in Christ, not counting men's sins against them. And he has committed to us the message of reconciliation. We are therefore Christ abandoned us. So God was making his appeal through us. We implore you on Christ's behalf, be reconciled to God. Several things that come out in that passage. The message we have is from God. So do not greet your own message. Evangelism means sharing God's message. What he has taught you, what is in the scriptures. Don't go creating your own message. All this is from God. Why? He is the one who reconciled us to himself. So what is evangelism? Evangelism is the process of bringing friendship between an unchristian and Christ.
To reconcile people, it means earlier you are not friends. Now reconciling means you have become friends. So evangelism is having friends, is helping people to become friends with God. But he is saying Christ himself is the one who reconciled us to himself. Only then do you become qualified to have the ministry of reconciliation. Two things that come there. Number one, that you cannot become God for evangelism if you yourself have not been reconciled. Because you are saying, Christ is my friend, come and see my friend. If he's not your friend yet, how can you help others be friends with him? And that's why he's saying that he first of all reconciled us, and then he gave us the ministry of reconciliation. So the first thing is, you yourself must be born again. But number two, it is important to understand that once you are born again, the way you know you are born again, you are given
the responsibility to become an adult.
You get that message if you read your Bible? That he gives him from God. He reconciled us and then gave us the ministry of reconciliation. So question mark. You cannot claim you are reconciled if you are not reconciling others. The way you know you yourself are reconciled is that he has given you the ministry of reconciliation. It's a critical thing in the passage. That if you are not witnessing, chances are you yourself are not saved. Are you getting that message from the verse? So that he say, because he has reconciled, he has given you the ministry of reconciliation. Of course, I know when you are a new believer, you might need what you call discipline. But the Bible actually says, you don't just convert, you are supposed to be discipled. But the way to know you have become a disciple, not just a convert, is that you start bearing fruit. The same thing with the car. Those of you who have grown up in the rural area, are there boys like me who grew up in the rural area? I came to Nairobi to come to university. I was a little boy. The nearest I came was Alliance, which was not in town. Now, I can tell you, in the rural area, you can tell a cow has become a cow. How do you tell? A cow is a small cow. Am I right? Yeah, how do you tell a cow has become a cow? I'm sorry, because we are from the rural area, you must know the answer. How do you tell a calf has become a calf? Number one? Size, yes. Number two? Do you know there are calves that grow very quickly? But there are two calves. So size cannot go there. Some calves are very small, even when they are mothers. You are using me? Yeah, so how can you tell a calf, yes? When it starts taking milk.
When it stops feeding on milk and start eating grass, then.
No, but it's still a cow, even after the milk. For a while, why are you only a cow? Don't confuse from the area. My friend, that even when the cow is not taking milk, it's still called a cow. When do you stop calling it a cow? Good! The way you know you become mature is you start bearing others. Am I communicating? When you start bearing other children, you yourself are mature. Because children don't bear children. Are we together? So it's important to understand that you are a very Christian, living sacred, if you have not come to the level where you are starting to share with others. Am I clear? That's what he said. He reconciled us and then gave us the ministry of reconciliation. And that's basically something that must be, that is in verse 18. Then verse 19 goes on and says that God was reconciling the world to himself in Christ, not counting men's sins against them. What is it we are talking about evangelizing people? Because every non-Christian is here is at a condemnation. They are certainly going to hell. But when they come to Christ and repent their sins are no longer counted on them. And that's why sometimes non-Christians don't understand that.
See, you tell them I'm going to heaven. See, which heaven? But yet, and you follow the teacher. It's true, you did. But you know something? When you come to Christ in repentance, He no longer counts your sin against you. How many is the difference? You are not guilty. So that this Christian and this non-Christian can do the same thing. But I want to tell you the difference between a Christian and a non-Christian. When a Christian does a sin, the Holy Spirit gets hold of him. And there's such a conviction. Sometimes you see men crying in the cathedral when the Holy Spirit gets you. It's a dangerous thing to fall in the house of the Messiah. And anybody born again here knows what I'm talking about. When you know the Spirit of God has called you, nobody has called you, nobody even knows about you. But you feel such a sense of guilt, you cannot face it. So what do you do? If you truly are born again, the conviction is not to destroy you, it's to send you to the cross. And you go to the cross, you repent your sins, and as you realize the forgiveness of God, you come out of your prayer closet, aware of God's forgiveness, rejoicing at the goodness of God, and hearing how far as a person you are. Is that your experience? In the meanwhile, this guy, you think he ever regards having done wrong? Does he regard it as anything wrong? The only thing that bothers a man a Christian is being caught. So if he does something, he's not caught. How could I see that? But for this one, there's no need to be caught by anybody else. The Holy Spirit catches him. If you see somebody driving and he asks you, hey, nobody is ahead, please know where he's going. He's going to hell. Because you need to understand that if you're a Christian, you don't need to be a policeman. The Holy Spirit is in you. Are we together? That a Christian does not do wrong in the fear of police. He fails to do wrong in fear of God. How can you get different? It's a poor thing. You know there are girls who actually don't want to sleep with a boy because they don't want to get pregnant. They don't want to embarrass their parents. So if you are sure if they sleep with a boy, they don't get pregnant and they don't get AIDS, they will do it. So once a boy convinces that they are condoms and they will do both, prevent AIDS and prevent pregnancy, the girl says, come on, no problem. Because for her, the violation of sin is getting caught. You are not a Christian. You are only a sinner. You get caught. And unfortunately, the church behaves also like that. You have this. People in the youth fellowship, they are sleeping with boys. You don't bother with them. The day one girl gets pregnant, the elders stand up and roll them. I'm not even. How do you advance our church by getting pregnant? And see, nothing wrong with getting pregnant. In fact, pregnancy is a blessing. How many women are trying to get pregnant? They cannot be pregnant. It's important to understand that pregnancy is a... What is the problem with this whole thing that they push? Now, and you need to understand, sin is not a pregnancy. Sin is what they did that day. Together. So the ones who did it and never got pregnant are as simple as the ones who did and got pregnant. Are you understanding the difference? So you start understanding that there is a big difference when you are a Christian. Your life is guided by the conviction of the Spirit. So I may talk to her and talk about me. Talk to her about me. She may not even bother with me. She says, the throne was a visitor. But for me, I'll go away with a sense of guilt to the point of crying before the Lord. And you forgive me. So you can keep saying, but Mama, he calls himself a Christian. He talks badly. You think I'm going to hell? I am not. Because the Lord has forgiven. Am I communicating?
Yes.
Because that's what we are talking about. Now the word of God is telling us the reason we do evangelism is so that the people of the world, their sin may not be counted from them. And you know, to become a Christian is such a marvelous thing. Psalm 103 says, He takes away our sins as far as east is from west. So evangelism is assisting someone to get forgiveness. Because when they are forgiven, their history of sin no longer bothers them. Because God forgets all the sin. It's correct and good to say that when you become a Christian, it's like the Lord forgets your sin. He takes your sin and buries it in the sea of forgetfulness. In other words, God's forgetfulness is like a sea. And He buries it. Correct and good says, after that He puts a signboard, not fishing. So anything God has forgiven, we are not supposed to remember. Do you know that you're already imagining? You got a girl, a Christian. Do you remember what you did at that bush? It is true, I did it for the devil, but I'm forgiven. So if God bother you, if he cannot bother you again, because it is forgiven. That's a privilege of Christian. And a Christian keeps wondering, hey, you know what about it? What has happened? But when a Christian does something wrong, and they are repenting, it's completely forgiven. To the extent, as far as he is wrong, well, you know the Bible is so, it's such an interesting book, that you can only believe that God is the top scientist. If the Bible has, and you know, because it was written more than 2,000 years ago, when it was written, something was written, if it can say that he takes out our sins as far as north is from south, do you know that you can count the kilometers? Because there is a point called north, another one called south. So you can count the kilometers, am I right? But do you know there is no point called west? If you really are going to the east, you will keep going to the east until you arrive in Europe. Those who have that Europe, am I right? So that when he says he takes away your sins as far as east and west, it means uncountable distance. I'm getting the difference that if you have said north to south, it's a measurable distance. But your sins are not away from you measurably. They are immeasurable. Does that excite you? To know that it does not matter what you did yesterday. In as long as you are genuinely dependent, the blood of Jesus cleanses us from all sin. So evangelism is allowing the non-Christian to know the privilege and joy of forgiveness. Because as he sits there, all the things he has done in history, his worry is getting caught. Remember, he's not worried about the sin. He's worried about getting caught. But he needs to come to where he knows that sin will not be counted on him. If he has pledged with God, he can be assured of heaven because he is forgiven. That's what the passage is telling us about evangelism. Then goes on to say, and he has committed to us the message of organization. We therefore are Christ's ambassadors. You realize the day you become a Christian, you become Christ's representative on earth. That means in the chemistry class in Kenya, if you are a Christian, you are Christ's ambassador to that class. If that class does not get to know about the Lord, Ezekiel was told, if people who are with him do not get to know the message God has given, he will require their blood out of their hands. Have you read Ezekiel? That it means that if you are in chemistry class, you are their partner. God's hand, maybe the microphone that is called you, your excellence. But that's what you are. You are representing heaven in that chemistry class. In your own family, you will be the youngest. But if you know the Lord, you are Christ's ambassador. Are you getting the point? That's what you need to understand. You cannot be an ambassador. Three things, once you're an ambassador. One, you can't be an ambassador and do your own program. Because the president of your country is the one who gives you a program. That's why you become a Christian. You understand you must follow the program of God. Number two, once you're an ambassador, you cannot manga. Do you know you cannot be an ambassador in God of Almighty? Once you're in a country, the other day I was in an ambassador, a Kenyan ambassador, another country, I was speaking in a conference. And he asked me to go home and said, please stop being an ambassador. He was telling me, you cannot just enter anywhere. Because that country normally has special priority on you. They are checking what you are doing. You must behave in a certain way. In fact, since they cannot take you to court, as soon as you misbehave, you must return home. Okay, is that point? Now you're an ambassador. It means you cannot do what you like. You do what the president of your country likes. I'm sure you have heard me say this. Let me repeat it. The last choice a Christian makes is the choice of Christ. From then onwards, he will never make another choice. Everything you do after that is you do whatever Christ wants. So the business of a Christian is to fight God's will, not to choose. You don't choose. Then you leave. The last choice a Christian makes is the choice of Christ. From then onwards, you never make a choice. I'm sure you may have heard me say, if you meet a boy, and they say, me, I can never marry a Mutaika. Don't ask him whether he is saved. You know he is not well. Because you see, the day a Christian boy gets to know Christ, he loses the choice of who you marry. You don't marry your choice. You marry God's choice. You find who God has chosen for for you. You don't even choose the career. You see the kind of God that chose the career for you. You don't even choose the job.
You go to the job God has chosen. I think I told the graduating class last year, but I can't remember when I talked to the graduating class here.
It's critical to understand that even in a passenger, you don't do what you like. You do what your country likes. And that way, if you are in a passenger, you know you have a term of office. You are not there forever.
So for example, you are not in the graduating class forever.
So, we need not time to come into class and have graduated, am I right? And you have no way of telling them you have presented your message. So you cannot be sitting next to somebody, you have a roommate, and you start thinking you will be forever. No! You can't tell the next semester and you will not be a roommate. It is only as your roommate that you must carry out your registration and apply. But ambassadors have a terms of office. Are we together? So that he may be in Britain. The next time he may end up in Germany, he is moved from place to place. Lastly, in that passage, I want you to understand that evangelism, the verse 20 says, as though God were making his appeal through us. I made mention of that before. We implore. In other words, evangelism is not telling. Evangelism is begging.
Okay, understand that.
In other words, you are begging this person. You are imploring him. You are, can you see the word that I call it? That when you go to an Christian, you don't tell him, chukua upende, usipende. He doesn't know what he's missing. And you who knows what he's missing. He doesn't know of the fire of hell. And you understand he's going to hell. So it is the Bible is saying we implore, we plead with the people. And that's what we are talking about in evangelism. How to go finishing. Next, I want to deal with excuses that stop one-on-one evangelism. Excuses that stop one-on-one evangelism. Number one, people say that evangelism is not my gift. Now, when you say evangelism is not my gift, the implication is that witnessing is a gift. I've run out of time, I've just looked at my watch, I don't have enough time to deal with it. But please understand, the book of Acts, chapter 1, verse 8, says, wait in Jerusalem, when the Holy Spirit comes on you, you will become my witnesses. That message was not addressed to the 12 apostles. If you look at the passage, it was addressed, verse 15, it was addressed to 120. In other words, the room had 120 people. And all of them were told, when the Holy Spirit comes, you will be my witness. What does that mean? That pastoring is a gift. Witnessing is a call. Okay, see the difference? Pastoring is a gift. Witness is a call. And it's a call on everyone. That's what I've been trying to establish since I started. That witnessing is not for a special gift for someone. All of us have a gift. So to say, but you know me, I'm not good at witnessing. Who told you have to be good? That's not a requirement. The Bible is saying, as soon as the Holy Spirit comes upon you, he appoints you as a witness. First Corinthians said, he appoints you as an ambassador. You must understand who you are. So do not mistake preachers for witnesses. All witness required is to show the thing happened. You don't have to understand the law. Those of you who know something about court cases, do they normally ask a witness whether he has a degree in law? All they ask is, do you appear there? See it. So all you need is, are you born again? That's all you require to become a witness. So you cannot say that the reason I don't care about God at all is because you are not one, and that's the first excuse. There are excuses that people say, hey, you know me, I'm not talkative. Because they think that to be talkative means to become a witness. Do you know there are people who cannot be witnesses by talking to people? They just put off. If you are talkative, you come to me and run away. But if you are quiet, and you come telling me, you know the law. I admire your quietness. There are certain people who the only thing who can reach them is a quiet one. Of course, the others are already reached by the major one. That's why the Lord has not the Christians, quiet Christians, funny Christians, smiling Christians, lugubrious Christians. Every Christian has a candidate he can reach. Am I clear? So you cannot start talking about the future. One more for this excuse that I don't have a gift. Please understand, it is also true. There are the people with the gift of evangelism. Whatever witnessing is a call, evangelism can be a gift. And you can feel the difference. The two of us can go in the city. Five people get to know the Lord. Me, only one gets to know the Lord. Same period of time. Is that true? Have you experienced that? There are some people with an anointing for evangelism. But since all of us are given the gift of, are given the call of evangelism, one, two. So if we leave it always with the gift, she will go alone. So she will come back and find, say, if we go together, well, how many will we have?
Six.
Are you getting the difference? That's why you cannot allow only the gifted to do it. Because the gifted will bring, for example, we are 10 of us. 5 of us are gifted. So 5, 50. If the other 5 are also getting 1, 1, it will be 55. Everybody get the difference? So it's important to understand that although it is true some people are gifted in evangelism, it does not mean the ones who are not gifted don't do anything. It means it's still true because there's no fruit. Let me give you something that I find very interesting. Some pastors are imperfect. In fact, that people even when they introduce themselves, I'm John Nana Evangelist International. It implies that he is the one who does it. Others, the pastor seems to understand when they don't witness. After all, they don't have the gift. That's not in the scriptures. The same pastors are very interesting. Do you know there is a gift on giving? The Bible talks about it. A gift of giving. There are people who don't just give. They give a thing one. Do they understand? They are children who have nothing to eat. But there is something in them that really. Have you met people like that? Who just have a ministry of giving? Have you met them? Let me ask you. Have you ever had a pastor who says during the offering, like you were taking the offering earlier, who says, now is the time of offering. Those of you without the gift of giving, please let the bag pass. All that, you can put the money in the bag. Ever had a pastor like that? So when it comes to giving, pastor says, when it comes to witnessing, the only one, the ones who are gifted to witness. That's what scripture. I'm getting the point. That even when it comes to giving, all of us must give. But those who have the anointing for giving will give even. Are you getting the point? So you don't sit there saying that you don't have a gift. Another excuse. As long as I lead a godly life, others will see Christ in me. That's what I'm supposed to do. Have you heard that excuse? That me, I don't think about it, they will see through my action. That's a total lie. The best an unchristian will see is that you look like a Christian. But they don't know that you are. They just look like you are. And you think yourself at best you are, they can't prove it. In a court of law, if somebody says, for example, says, oh yeah, you know, you are so a Christian. For example, let's say there is a rule that everybody who is a Christian is going to be killed. So everybody is being gathered. And they bring you to the judge. And the idea is they want to convict you so that they kill you. So they ask, give us the evidence. Or if you to attend the Kenya Sands Christian Union, the defense lawyer will say, well, they are not many people. Was Kenya Sands Christian Union close to other people? Was only for Christians? Everyone was open. Do you think the judge will convict that person? No. Says, but you wear a wrong dress. Surely, there was a fashion of wrong dresses. Did that mean they are Christian? Do you know the only way she can be convicted is when the person says, I had her say she is born again. And so also hard. What are two witnesses who had her? Is there any difference anymore? That's why some of you don't even say you are saved. Because if you say you'll be convicted. What I'm trying to get you to understand is that you need to share. Romans chapter 10 says, faith comes by? Yes. So if you want an unchristian to have faith in God, no amount of acting will help you. You must get to know the Lord. By the way, this is a message in my website. So maybe you can pick it in my website.
My website is, since I'm here, it's a run out of time. Don't put apostrophes on the Ganga. That is www.johnganga.org. So you find the message there. If you
subscribe, I can be sending you my messages on a weekly basis. But the point I'm trying to get you to see, which is a very important point for you as a witness, is to understand very, very, very clearly that actions
speak louder than words, but only because they amplify the words. May I repeat? Actions speak louder than words because they amplify the words. Like this, an amplifier. Did you hear anything? No. I must talk for it to amplify. In that way, your Christian life amplifies your testimony. If you are not testimony, nothing will be amplified. Are you getting my point? I'm not suggesting that words are not important. While you are Christian, you walk differently. Because you don't walk to please the flesh, you walk to please God. So your life will be different. But now, your life will be amplified what your mouth has said. So you must, for others to get to know the Lord as their Savior, it will be important. So it's not an excuse worth mentioning. To fail to share with your friends, and your excuse is, I'm living God life. God life is not witnessing. Faith does not come in by watching. Just look at the verse. Faith does not come by watching. Faith comes by hearing. They must hear your testimony. And I think I have to finish. Because if I go on. But I wanted to finish by telling you that Christianity must involve taking an initiative. And I think I've said it enough. You must be the person who goes to the next person, not the person coming to you. Bill Bright, the one who began Campus Crusade of Life Ministry, says it is important, evangelism is taking the initiative to share Christ. Taking the initiative to share Christ is the power of the Holy Spirit in leaving the results to God. And I think that's what I want to leave with you. That when you go to the other person, three things, you are taking the initiative. And sometimes it's very difficult. You can go to talk to the person and you talk, finally, you don't have told him about the Lord. You take the initiative. Number two, share the Lord Jesus. You have not done witness, you have just enjoyed talking until you introduce Jesus to that person. Witnessing is not just talking. Witnessing is sharing the Lord Jesus. So it's important to understand. And the word of God summarizes what the gospel is. The gospel is sharing who Christ is, sharing why he died, and sharing the benefits of his death. That must be shared. The Life Ministry has summarized it in the four spiritual laws. The four spiritual laws, the idea is generalized in the gospel. Getting the person to understand the love of Christ that caused Christ to die on the cross. That is what you must. You must share Christ with the people. That's what Peter Bryce is sharing. Taking the initiative to share the Lord Jesus Christ. But number three, you are not witnessing until you do it in the power of the Holy Spirit. It is taking the initiative to share the Lord Jesus Christ in the power of the Holy Spirit. That means you don't go in your cleverness, your philosophy. You pray, God, I'm about to talk to this person. Please go before me. Give me the power. And the interesting thing is, sometimes you go to the person and you realize God does something that you don't understand. He is about to take your word. And sometimes you can't even understand how he takes it. And so itself, the other day for God to demonstrate this message for me was very interesting. I was invited by the Kenyan Fellowship in Dar es Salaam to share because I used to work for Shell and I was covering about 10 countries. One of them is Tanzania. So they told me, next time you're on duty in Tanzania, we'd like you to run a seminar for the professionals who are working in Tanzania. So then they say, you do that on a Friday, then on Saturday, we want you to go to Manta, on Sunday, another church. They have quite a program for me. So in addition to, Friday happened to have been a holiday. So I was working in the Instagram for Monday, Tuesday, Thursday for Shell. Then on the weekend, I stayed on to do ministry. And so on Sunday, in the middle of the week, the pastor of the Nisaran Pentecostal Fellowship, Chuck, came to my hotel room and said, you are speaking to us on Sunday. Now, we have a needy servant, a Swahili servant. Would you speak in the school? You need an interpreter for the Swahili one. I told you, my Swahili is bad. But unfortunately, I also know that interpreters are interrupters. They basically interfere with your topic. So I don't enjoy interrupters. So if your people don't mind my bad Swahili, they are not trying to look for Kiswahili Sanifu. I can talk without an interpreter. Then it's okay, they don't care. All they want is the word. He agreed.
On Sunday I went, and the first service was English. In fact, it's about of Kenya. And I can tell you, the Lord was at work.
People got saved.
As we went back to the vestry, we were all rejoicing about the goodness of the Lord and how He had brought conviction. Now we went to the Swahili service. Again, it went on. I preached. Again, people got saved, despite my bad Swahili. Can you imagine my sentiment? I went to see, feeling very nice. The Lord had blessed me. When you're the vestry, says, Mungu wakani kazi, lakini ni kiswahili chako. Hi, Sayaki, Pastor, so what was wrong with my Swahili?
He said that Swahili was terrible. It was worse than that. Yeah, I didn't realize it and he laughed back.
I said, so what did I say? He said, you really want to know?
Yes.
So he said, unakumbuka ulitwambia wewe, uliokoka ukiwa kijana. Yes, true, I was in the North Yam. Baadaye ukaoa bibi. Yes, she's called Rebecca. And baadaye ukapata watoto naye. Hey, would you like to hear what is that in English? Said, yeah. What is this? So simple. Says, I'll tell you. According to what the people had, you told us the following. Despite getting saved as a young boy, when you grew older, you went ahead and married your grandma. Nyanya wiki. It's not a person. Nyanya wiki. So bibi means a grandmother. The word is bibi. Not about the wife. That is bibi.
Why did you stop me in the meeting and explain? I said, it's down here with you.
But you should have done it. You know, I had them to walk out. When I walk all those people outside, I can't greet them. When they know I end up with my grandmother. It was a terribly embarrassing occasion. But the Lord saved people despite my mess. I mean, my point is that when you go witnessing, don't go in your power. Go in the power of the Lord. That's what we are saying. What is witnessing? Taking the initiative. In other words, take the front. Go to the person. Go to the person. But only do it in the power of the Holy Spirit. And then share Christ. Not stories. Not about Manchester being beaten by Manchester United. Not Manchester City. No, that's not a witness. That's not a story. Are we together? You must share Jesus Christ. Then find us.
In the same portion, and I'm finishing with this, I told you. Leaving the resource to God. In other words, no amount of talking can save anyone. The best you can do is convince people. But people don't get saved because they are convinced. They get saved because they are convicted.
Man can convince. Only the Holy Spirit can convince. So where did they get saved? Don't be proud. It's not you who did it. It's Christ that did it. When you don't get saved, don't stop witnessing. It's not your problem. After all, you are, the Bible calls it throwing the seed, isn't it? And you don't want it to fall on wood, soil. Now, the best example I have is of the Maasai. See the Maasai here? You understand what I'm saying? The Maasai normally takes an arrow, put poison. He cannot run at the speed of an arrow. But when he did the arrow, he quickly releases the arrow. As soon as he sees the arrow has touched the other one, he stops running. He just follows the other one. Why? He knows in a matter of a few minutes, that poison will start working on that other one and you will fall ahead of him. How can you avoid it? But of course, finally you'll find it fallen and you are dismayed. In the same way, our witnessing in the power of the Holy Spirit is like an arrow with poison. If you hate a person, you reject Christ. 5 years later, he'll remember that message. And in his own bedroom, he will come to know the Lord. Because the poison as far as they can live. So when you witness, do not stop witnessing because people have not got and saved. You have no power to save anyone. Your job is not to save. Your job is to tell. It's Christ who reserves the responsibility of convicting. Let us pray. Lord Jesus, you want us to do one-on-one evangelism. Although we may not have fully covered the topic, I'm praying that everybody born again here will come to the point where he knows he has no choice, but for the rest of his life, when I am, and even though he's an old man or an old woman, all the days of his life must be a time of sharing Jesus Christ with those who bring his way or her way. Commission us, Lord. But there may be people here who don't have the knowledge of the privilege of walking with Christ. I'm praying as you have shared the difference between a Christian and a Christian, you bring them to the point of conviction. That you may not just become, continue becoming people who attend the Christian union, but you start enjoying the privilege of walking with Christ and enjoying that walk. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.